what is central and what's important in the learning experience of our students. What are the questions we want to be sure that when we hand our students a diploma, what is it that we're handing them? What has their experience been? So that's one of the points that I would make. I think going forward, one of the questions we ask also is this experience we're looking at how we discern our own worthwhile work? Pope Francis says, all we need to do, you know, we tell our students, they're saints, because all we have to do is live our lives in love and bear witness to God in all we do. The important thing is that each one discerns their own path, that they bring out the very best of themselves, the most personal gifts God has placed in their hearts. Who is God calling you to be? I know at a number of times we take students away and we reflect as well on the three famous questions. Is what you're doing a source of joy? Is this something that taps into your talents and gifts, engages all of your abilities, and uses them to the fullest potential? Is this something somebody wants? Is this role a genuine service to the people around you, to society at large? Those are three pivotal questions. And in our focus on student formation, both in the classroom and outside, those are something. One of the joys of being at Emmanuel to me has always been the sense of vocation that our faculty and our staff have definitely had. You see that when you look, yes, I jumped. You see that when we look at how many people have contributed, not just in the hours that they're in their offices or the time that they're in the classroom, but how much more it is for so many here. And I think going forward, as we look at celebrating a deeply rooted faith, we look at our own legacy. And it seems to me that we think of a legacy. I put this picture up because we began that in the first year, class of 1923, Margaret Higgins' daughter, class of 53, granddaughter, class of 87, great-granddaughter, Hannah, class of 19. Now, we have a number of legacy, not everyone, but I think that's what brings us to the legacy. So what we talk about now, so, yeah. Oh, no, you got it afterwards. Okay, so my question to you, what would you like to write? What are the stories you'd like to write as we begin the second century? What rising needs in our country and our world can Emmanuel address today? Because legacy doesn't stop. And I would say to you that this mission, this vision, belongs to everyone in this room and beyond. This mission is not just, hasn't been for a long time, part of one group. It is not just the Sisters of Notre Dame. 27 years ago, Jesse reminded us, is when we began. Why did we begin having days like Founders Days, or now Founders Weeks? It was because for many years prior to that, there were so many people who were in touch, not just with the beginning, but also with the Sisters of Notre Dame. When I came here, as I think I told you, there were 70 sisters here living in residence halls, as well as chairs of departments, working always with amazing lay people, amazing faculty, who were totally dedicated to this mission. But now this legacy, this mission, belongs to everyone here. And so the charge is, how do you move it forward? How do you move it forward? And I put that to you as a question, and I only have one two plants in the audience to address it, but I'd like to hear from about more than that. And before we move into the answering the question, I have a few reflections there which focuses back again on the vocation. Really, if you look at someday, that's the first one in the middle, Someday, after mastering the winds, the waves, the tides, and gravity, we shall harness the energies of love. And for the second time in the history of the world, we will have discovered fire, as by the paleontologist, Théodore Chardin. And if you think, where is that coming from? It's tying back to what Pope Francis was talking about in terms of it's love that's at the center, of love that gives the passion, that assures the mission. And that's what. And then the other one is fall in love, stay in love, it will decide everything. And then Mary Oliver, who died a couple of weeks ago, tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? So those are questions, but each one at different ways of answering, both together as part of community, college, and individually. So let me hear from you in terms of how you see this mission or this vision continuing. I did used to teach.
Sister Jan, a few remarks, and I wanted to say a thank you to everybody for the support and participation and celebration of Founders Week. And I did have some prepared words, but really looking, I have lots of stories I could share about my own experience of being an Emmanuel student and working here for some time. But really for me, I think as far as what's unique and it's really touched me as I've reflected this week and thought about it is the model that the Sisters of Notre Dame have given to us, and that's the real legacy, the real gift that I've received and I've seen through our students, particularly our students who are in service and through the 1804 Society, of model of goodness and a model of using one's education to promote God's goodness locally and globally. And that's something that I think makes us uniquely Emmanuel and something that, looking at this question, that our country really needs, that if God is good all the time, and that is something that we can promote and spread, and that's a model that the sisters have provided to us.
And I think so much of the engagement of our current students, I think, was it last Saturday that you had the service day for alumni and students? So I think it starts here, but it continues, you know, it's the multiplier effect. It continues beyond that as well. Thank you for sharing.
Plant number two. but I'm not prepared, Sister Susan, I'm very happy to be able to say, yesterday I had an opportunity to meet with a good number of faculty, and I used to worry about what would happen when the last Sister of Notre Dame crossed the front gate and that was it. I don't worry about that anymore, not with the men and women that I have worked with, that I chat with, that I see. That the mission is not with the cross, it's not with Sister Janet or myself, it's with every single person, students included, but the faculty, I think, are the leaders going forward, and I am so impressed, and it's just, we're really grateful for you, because, you know, I look up there and I realize how old I am, because I had some of those people that were in the slides, and in those days, you couldn't walk across the campus without bumping into a black veil and kind of like, hi, you know, she didn't see me, I didn't get to class. But that's not the case anymore, and yet the mission and the vision is, from my perspective, more impactful on students, I think, today than it was even when I was a student, because it was just taken for granted when I was here. Yeah. So I'm very grateful for each and every one of you, beyond faculty, staff as well. I don't mean to not include you.
And one time, Tom Wall was quoted in a couple of news articles saying what it was like to be able to absorb the mission and why for the last 27 years we've been more intentional. Some of that comes from Ex Corde and asking people who are doing this, every Catholic college in the country, is thinking more aware what was the founding vision and what's the vision and the mission today. So that was very much part of it. And I was thinking, when Deirdre was speaking, A couple of weeks ago, at some event, it was December, some other little known fact. Way back in 1941, Emmanuel College gave an honorary degree to a person who is now a really canonized saint. Her name is Saint Catherine Drexel. Catherine Drexel was a very, she had a large fortune, and she founded a religious congregation called Sisters of Blessed Sacrament, whose focus was on African American and Native American children. And so there's a parish that Deidre's connected to in Dorchester now called St. Catherine Drexel. And after I told your pastor the story, he said, here we were, so that's the only saint, the only canonized saint that we give an honorary degree to that we know of. And so it's pretty amazing back then that that's what happened. And that's very much a part. This college has always been ahead and looking ahead of what was to come. She planned.
Well, it's kind of ironic. My baby sister just handed me this microphone. I'm going to reflect on this first question because I think my story started 24 years ago exactly on this campus when my parents got married here. And the story is going to continue. I think very recently I had a pivotal moment in my life where I looked back at my career, kind of new, but I looked back and I wasn't happy, and I was kind of reflecting on what would make me happy and what would make this story continue. And my answer was Emmanuel, and it was kind of funny because of course it whittles down to this very room. Just as I said, my sister and I have started a new chapter in our relationship, me as a faculty member, her as a almost graduating senior next year. And it just continues on, and I think it's very poignant that I started my career here just 2 months ago, and we are now entering the next century, and it's just really important for me and for all of my peers here in this room to really recognize where we've come from and where we're going, and I think that's a huge question right now that I'm about to answer. So, very excited. Thank you, Sister Janet.
Kathleen and Molly's grandfather.
Hi, Lisa Schneier, School of Education. One of the things I'm thinking about is how deeply rooted the value of education is in this college. And as a member of the School of Education, I particularly value that. And the other is how deeply rooted our capacity for faith is in this institution. And I feel like both of these are so direly needed right now with the urgencies that are taking over our society for taking our own deep-rooted faith and values and being able to use them, use our own identities, our own secure identities to embrace the identities of others, particularly those who have been oppressed in the traditions that have founded our country. And I feel like this institution roots us well for that work of the next century.
Everybody, I'm John Paul Sittner. I teach in the Theology and Religious Studies department. And I want to say why I particularly am enjoying and moved by working at Emmanuel College right now. This might take too long, if so, I apologize. Right now, we're in a position in American history where facts and reason do not seem to be very well valued. And I really think the people who founded our country were of a whole bunch of different religious persuasions, but they were all very much children of the Enlightenment. They value facts and reason. And I see the nation's colleges as protectors or guardians of that Enlightenment tradition. And at the same time, I enjoy being at Emmanuel College because it's also a religious college. But it believes that religion and facts and reason, faith, facts, and reason, are all compatible. So here we have the opportunity to answer the religious call to hope, not just in our spiritual lives, but also for our nation's future. And not just to hope, but to act on that hope, and to hope that we can return to a nation that values facts and reason, and makes good decisions, not just for the rich and powerful, but for all Americans, including marginalized Americans, and that increasingly includes the excluded in our culture. And that's something that I think we do well here at Emmanuel College, and that we will continue to do well in Emmanuel College, and that we can do as an expression of our collective hope. Thank you.
I wasn't going to say anything because I'm relatively a newbie. But I'm Janice Bell-Meisenhelder. I'm a professor of nursing. And Emmanuel, nursing is more than knowledge and skills. Nursing is heart. And I came to Emmanuel because here I have permission to teach the heart of a nurse. And Emmanuel equips nurses with the faith foundation to give them the courage to walk into a room of a dying patient. The faith foundation that gives them the peace to help people who are suffering and deal with it in their own peace. Gives them the faith foundation to have the moral courage to advocate for patients against whatever power they may need to do what's best for that patient and that client. And that makes me very proud to be at Emmanuel. Thank you.
I think we should recognize something that we haven't fully celebrated yet, and that is the good news that we received and you've read about. But I think there's some people here from our nursing department, and we're just delighted with the work that they have done, and that we now have our accreditation for the undergraduate 18-year-old beginning clinical nursing. So thank you to you. I think a few of your colleagues are here as well today. Still have time for a few other answers to this question, and you don't have to get them all out today, but we do one here.
Well, I just have one or two sentence statement to make, and that is the joy of teaching in an institution where my students respect each other. It makes it so nice to be able to have conversation and discussion because there's tolerance for all kinds of views and a freedom to speak and a respect for that. And that just means a lot from the front of the room, I have to tell you, that we really learn from each other. And I value that very, very much.
So I've been here for 50 years, and I've seen lots of changes. And at one stage, we had 44 faculty members. And the resources were slim, so we didn't fight about any of the resources. We became really good friends. And that was the core, I think, of the faculty moving forward in those days. Now, one of the things that happened is that these 44 became over 100. And it happened all at once. We hired almost 60 faculty members in just a few years. And I remember you, Sister Janet, saying, Tom, how are we going to integrate them, get them to understand the mission of the place that quickly? Well, we did it. And echoing Sister Susan, I am really pleased with the way this faculty has sort of adopted the, originally it was the Sisters of Notre Dame when I came here, the five pillars who were chairs of departments. And if you didn't shape up and get into the mission of the place right away, you were in trouble. They taught us very quickly. And that mission has been passed on to the 44 and then to the 110 that we have now. What a really good faculty and bunch of members of this community we have. I'm so delighted to have been here for 50 years. Maybe not 50 more, but many more. Thank you.
Because my teachers also, Sisters of Notre Dame in Massachusetts, also opened two colleges in Japan, one in 1924. When Sister Helen Madeline stopped being the dean, she was the dean and president and everything, and other people at the time, she absolutely was the one in charge. When she was stopped on the way to California and helped that college, then she went over and founded and really established Notre Dame Station University in Okayama, and then after that, Junior College in Hiroshima. I'm going to put pictures up, but then in the 1990s, just the connection then, gave Sister St. John Watanabe, who was the president of the college at the time, and that's the head of all the Catholic colleges and universities in Japan, an honorary degree. And I had to fly over there to give it to her. And so I think that that was part of it. Wanted to mention Sister Margaret Pauline. She was a down to Isabella, and when in 1960 we decided to open a site in Brazil, and you know about that because of the current people who can speak here from Brazil. You certainly know the story of Sister Dorothy Staines being killed in Brazil, and also you heard Sister Mary Alice McCabe in 1980. It was Sister Margaret Pauline who went down to Brazil, very well trained and very experienced. She learned Portuguese from her Spanish. We started teaching Spanish and Portuguese, including the work with the people in Brazil and trained people, the sisters, and she went around to other parts of the country. So I've got a teaching to stay in New Orleans here. And I know my own teaching in the English department were almost back and forth from English department in the annual to Japan for a number of years. So that also points to the role of and the encouragement.
Hi everyone, I'm Fran Badiato. I'm a senior at Emmanuel here. In reflecting on my time here, I have really taken to heart what the SMDs have done for women, for Emmanuel, and for the future of the college. And when I think about the time that I've spent in the classroom and outside of the classroom making connections, I am so grateful for the education that I've received, and I wish and hope that I will be a fraction as wonderful, outstanding, inspirational as my teachers, as a faculty, as a staff. I've really learned so much here, and I cannot wait to take that out into the world. And I feel that the college has really prepared me to be a student in the world, I guess, a student of the sisters, in a way, and to kind of push the mission that we've really taken to heart here. And I just want to say thank you to everyone. You, even though I may know you, I may not know you, but knowing that there's a friendly face here at Emmanuel has always been a real comfort to me. And Sister Janet, thank you so much for all the inspirational work you've done over the past 40 years. You have really made an impact on Emmanuel, and I can't wait to see what the next century holds.
This part of the program, and we have a wonderful wrap-up coming with Greg. Hare.
Thank you, Sister Janet, for your amazing stories of the past 100 years of Emmanuel, and for inspiring us for another century, as Fran mentioned. On behalf of the college, we'd like to present this small token of our gratitude. So thank you, Sister Janet.
That was wonderful.